trumpets sound, the angels sing, the feast is ready to begin. The gates of heaven are open wide, and Jesus welcomes you inside. Tables are laden with good things. Oh, taste the peace and joy he brings. He'll fill you up with love divine. He'll turn your water into wine. Sing with thankfulness songs of pure delight. Come and revel in heaven's love and light. Take your place at the table of the King. The feast is ready to begin. The feast is ready to begin. The hungry heart he satisfies, offers the poor his paradise. Now hear all heaven, earth applaud the amazing goodness of your Lord. Sing with thankfulness songs of pure delight. Come and revel in heaven's love and light. Take your place at the table of the King. The feast is ready to begin. The feast is ready to begin.
Jesus,
Jesus,
we thank you.
We thank you
for your love. For your joy.
Help us out, please.
Jesus,
Jesus,
we thank you.
We thank you
for the good thing.
For the good thing
you give to us.
You give to us.
Sing with thankfulness songs of pure delight. Come and revel in heaven's love and light. Take your place at the table of the King. The feast is ready to begin. The feast is ready to begin.
Yeah.
I have a confession to make. The last church that I served as an interim pastor was struck by lightning twice in a 3-week window. We have been struck by lightning twice since I've been here. No, that's quite all right. Exorcism is not required. It's just my electric personality. That's all I can say. It's my electric personality. No, I mean, I've been serving churches for 20 years. I've never had it happen until I started doing interim ministry. All I can say is that we're doing something right. And all I can say is that other church, they are going gangbusters now. So that means we've got good things in store, right? That being said, we have no screens. We have no visual because of the lightning strike. There was a ball of fire involved, from what I understand. I don't know. Microphone, lapel mic, we don't know about that either. So anyway, we'll just do it the old-fashioned way. We'll have to pull out our hymnals and punt from there. I do have some other announcements to lift up. Should I just turn this other one off? I may just put down the microphone and go back to the... we do have some announcements to lift up. Of course, this upcoming Saturday, I have... actually, since I have a...
Check, test. Here you go.
Like I said, it's my electric personality. Thank you, sir. Okay, is that better? Can you hear me now? Oh, good. Anyway, getting back to where I was, since I have a propensity toward pondering, I finally have proceeded to produce a proper name for this Saturday, and it appeared in my mind after we had the bulletin run, but the name I've come up with is Punch, Pray, and Proceed Party. Yeah? Yeah? It took me weeks to come up with that. But the Punch, Pray, and Proceed Party, this Saturday, 8 o'clock, we're going to gather over in the fellowship hall. Bring your hole punchers, if you got them. And we're going to punch holes in these. We got another stack just like these. And we're going to put rubber bands in them. And so we need people to punch. We need people to insert rubber bands. And then we need people, and this is great things to do with kids, to canvas the areas around us and pop these on, pop our postcards on to door handles. So we also then need people to bring refreshments, because we meet, we eat, right? We got to have our nourishment. And then most of all, we need people to pray while we're doing this. So please come this Saturday. I also decided we're going to call it Punch, Pray, and Proceed Party, also known as Help. Okay? Yes, ma'am. 8 a.m. Yes.
I know, I was like.
Well, you know, we got to punch them and put holes in them.
In the dark.
I know it. Just somebody's got to. They always do. Okay. Anyway, everybody clear about that? Yes. Okay. Got it. 8 o'clock this Saturday morning. Yes, ma'am. I think we'll eat whatever is brought. It's mainly, you know, as we have groups going out and coming back in and going back out, coming back in, people are going to need stuff to drink, snacks to eat. You know, it's kind of one reason about doing this in the morning is before it gets hot, before it gets too hot. And also, I'm sure many of us have lots of other things to do on Saturday, so rather than take up the whole day, we're just going to try to knock this out first thing in the morning. Amen? You are just so overwhelmed with the excitement about this. Arg! Okay. But this is to then advertise and promote what we have coming up after that. Next Sunday. Okay, so next Sunday, bring your backpack. Next Sunday's bring your backpack to church. I'm assuming they're all housebroken. So bring your backpack to church. We're going to have a blessing of the backpacks, okay? Okay, bring your backpack to church next Sunday. And tell your friends, bring your backpack to church. And then the Sunday after that is when we have our big back-to-school bash. So hopefully next Sunday we'll have a lot more information about that. And about all the fun we're going to have with that. I think that's about it. Are there any other announcements? Well, there's blessing and there's blessing. But, yeah, I guess we'll. Of course we're going to bless them. Yeah, it's just.
I have a special interest.
Well, blessing the teachers is a bit more. I mean, blessing the backpacks is a little bit more catchy for the kids than, you know. I mean, we could just call it, you know, back to school. Yes, amen. But No, we will bless the teachers and the everybody else that's hands on our children. So, well, who has hands on? Oh, that didn't come out right, did it? Okay.
Within legal sense.
Moving on. This has really gotten off to a strange start this morning. Anything else that we need to lift up? Oh, on the 6th of August, we will be having our Ocean Springs will be having their back to school worship service at the upper elementary school that evening. I will have to miss it because we also have our district a district meeting scheduled that evening. But so please, if you make a note of my lack of presence there, I have an excused absence.
I believe that's student-led.
Student and pastor-led, local pastors, area pastors lead it. And sometimes, a lot of times, there's students singing and leading music and stuff like that. Yeah. Anything else that we need to lift up? Okay, I think we just better get started on worship. What do you think? Okay, so let us please stand and join together our call to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made. What is it we're singing?
We are singing Days of Elijah.
Okay. Oh, good.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the cloud, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And those are the days of the harvest, the fields are as wide as your world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
This part's easy, you don't need any words.
There is no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and down to Zion's hill salvation comes.
Amen.
Well, if you remain standing and turn out, lift up your old-fashioned hymnal, and turn with me to page 785. I just have to say, some of you figured out that the words were, that projector up there is working, and some of you were turning around and using the words, and it reminded me of that we have a centering thing that we can go through, you know, to center ourselves, and we turn east and west and north and south, so y'all have done that, so y'all should be centered for worship. Amen? Well, we're going to read together Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Against you only have I sinned and done that which is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless in your judgment. Behold, you desire truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Make me hear with joy and gladness. Let the bones which you have broken rejoice. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. Deliver me from death, O God, God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your deliverance. For you have no delight in sacrifice. Were I to give a burnt offering, you would not be pleased.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
You may be seated. Well, it's now time for Kay to come up and lead us through our Bible passages.
A continuation of the story of David, 2 Samuel 11:22. When Uriah's wife heard that her husband was dead, she mourned him. After the time of mourning was over, David had her brought to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing David did was displeasing to the Lord. The Lord sent Nathan to David. When he came to him, he said, "There are two men in a certain town, one rich, the other poor. The rich man had a very large number of cattle and sheep, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb that he had bought. He raised it, and it grew up with him and his children. It shared his food, drank from his cup, and even slept in his arms. It was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, but the rich man refrained from taking one of his own sheep or cattle to prepare it for a meal for the traveler who had come to him. Instead, he took the ewe lamb that belonged to the poor man and prepared it for the one who had come to him. David burned with anger against the man and said to Nathan, "As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this deserves to die. He must pay for the lamb four times over because he did such a thing and had no pity." Then Nathan said to David, "You are the man. This is what the Lord God of Israel says. I anointed you king over Israel, and I delivered you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives. I gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if all this had been too little, I would have given you even more. Why did you despise the word of the Lord by doing what was evil in his eyes? You struck down Uriah the Hittite with a sword and took his wife to be your own. You killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now, therefore, the sword will never depart from your house, because you despised me and took the wife of Uriah the Hittite. This is what the Lord says. Out of your own household, I am going to bring calamity upon you. Before your very eyes, I will take your wives and give them to one who is close to you, and he will lie with your wives in broad daylight. You did it in secret, but I will do this thing in broad daylight before all Israel." Then David said to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord."
Well, so time for all those who are proud to be called children to come on down front and meet with Miss Page.
Wow, oh my goodness, we have princesses, we have princes. Good morning. I see that, that's pretty cool, yeah. You gotta show me your petticoat, huh? How many of you know your ABCs? Anybody know your ABCs? Can you sing it for me? Wow. You guys did a really good job. Did you have to memorize all that? It was something you had to memorize, right? You had to practice it over and over again. How many of you know how to read? A couple of you know how to read? Did you have to learn your ABCs before you could learn how to read? Pretty much, huh? Yeah. He can read? Oh, that's pretty good. Your brother can read. Both of them can read. That's really good. But you had to learn your alphabet, so those of you who don't know how to read yet, it's going to be okay. Because when you've learned your alphabet, next you'll learn how to read words. How many of you know how to add and subtract? Just a couple of you. All right. What's 4 plus 2? 6. All right. What's 522 plus 237? Oh, okay, okay, okay. You had to think about the second one, right? The first one you kind of got really easy, and it's because you practice it. We learn how to subtract and add, and we learn our alphabet so that we can learn how to be stronger later on in learning how to read and learning how to do math. So I have to ask you a question. How many of you have memorized scriptures from the Bible? No? Okay. Well, just like learning your ABCs and just like learning your numbers, when you learn about the Bible and you practice it and you practice it, then when the time comes, you'll remember Scripture, you know, just off the top of your head. So I'm going to give you one today, okay? You guys can memorize this one. It's called Psalm 119, 105. That's where you can find it. But what I want you to remember is the actual Scripture. It says, thy word, whose word? God's word, right. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet. Is that what his word is? It's a light down at my feet that's shining on the path? He didn't mean that literally, did he? He meant that if you use his word, it helps light your way. So thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Can you say that? Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Very good. As some of you are going back to school, some of you are starting school, and remember that God's word is a light there for you. It's there ready for you to just use and choose the right path. Okay? Let's bow our heads. Lord, we just thank you for showing us the way. And we ask, Lord, that you help us remember to read our Bible and to ask other people to help us learn some scriptures so that you can always light our way. We do this in your name. Amen.
The epistle reading is from Ephesians 4, 1 through 16. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you are called in one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of us all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has given us as Christ has proportioned. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he led captives in his train and gave gifts to men. What does he ascend mean except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers to prepare God's people for service so that the body of Christ may be built until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching
and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful schemes. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up to him who is the head, that is Christ. For him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in the love as each part does its work.
Stand and join us, please. In your hymnals, page number, hymn number 371, I Stand Amazed in the Presence. We'll be doing verses 1, 2, 4, and 5. 1, 2, 4, and 5.
I'll try to keep the lightning from striking again. I don't know how, but maybe you needed enlightening. Well, yes, I'm not going to say anything. Our gospel passage for this morning is a continuation of chapter 6 in John, beginning with the 24th verse and going through verse 35. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? Jesus answered them, Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal. Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, I'm the first one to admit that raising kids is tough. You laugh. I've got three teenagers. I think it's starting to show. And one of the toughest aspects of raising kids is making sure that they learn as to what is inappropriate language and what is appropriate language, right? Yeah. Now, in our home, our kids learn very early on the terrible inappropriateness of four-letter words, especially one four-letter word in particular. One I'm a little hesitant to say here in church, because it makes me that uncomfortable. The word is diet. Diet is simply not an acceptable word around our house, even though it's something we probably should be more mindful of. But I did recently come across a diet that I feel has some real promise, and it's called the stress diet. And evidently, there has been some proof that over time, it does work if you adhere to it. And I'd like to share it with you. It's if you would like a copy of it, please see me afterwards, and I'll give you a copy of it. Here's what the stress diet is. Breakfast, 1/2 a grapefruit, slice of whole wheat, toast, 8 ounces of skim milk. Lunch, 4 ounces of lean broiled chicken breast, 1 cup steamed zucchini, I love zucchini, 1 Oreo cookie, and herb tea. Mid-afternoon snack, rest of the package of Oreos, 1 quart Rocky Road ice cream or other equally appropriate flavor, and 1 complete jar of hot fudge. Supper, 2 loaves of garlic bread, large pepperoni and mushroom pizza with extra cheese, 2-liter bottle of regular Pepsi or Coke, not the diet, 3 Milky Way candy bars, and an entire Sara Lee pound cake eaten directly from the freezer. The stress diet. Well, once again this week, the gospel is talking about food, more specifically about bread. And if you find yourselves getting a little hungry with all this discussion about bread, well, you just might want to make sure that for the next few weeks on Sunday mornings you eat a good breakfast, because we're going to be talking about bread for a while, because Jesus is not done talking to us yet about bread. And I guess it was necessary for Jesus to go on and on and on about bread, about his being the bread of life, because the people back then just didn't seem to comprehend him. And I don't know why they couldn't comprehend him. I mean, what is it about God coming to earth as a human baby and growing up as a carpenter and turning out to be the Messiah and then being murdered for our sins is hard to comprehend? I mean, sure, they expected a Messiah that was easy to understand, one that was going to ride in on his white horse and relieve them from all that was wrong with the world. I mean, everything relating to God should be just that simple and clear-cut, right? Kind of like it is in back in the old movies or in comic books where the good is good and the bad is bad, and the good guys wear the white hats and the black guys wear black, and the ones who are going to get zapped or wear red. You got to be a Star Trek fan to get that one. But the truth of the matter is that everything relating to God more closely resembles a soap opera. Soap opera. With all the twists and turns that keep your head spinning, and people aren't always how you expect them to be, and where everything relating to Jesus is not always easy to grasp. We believe Jesus to be the full revelation of God, and whether we like it or not, whether we're willing to admit it or not, that revelation does not always come to us in a straightforward way, right? Yet we live as though we do fully understand, that we do fully comprehend, because we deceive ourselves into honestly thinking that we do. Yes? We think we've got God all defined and figured out, right? We just need to go to church. We need to do certain things and not do certain things. And we need to believe, and then we're set for eternity, right? Yeah? But when we live that path, we reduce Christianity into being nothing more than just another philosophy of life. It's far more complicated and complex than that. I don't know why we think that we should have Jesus all figured out when those who were right there with him day in and day out for 3 years, they didn't understand. They did not get it when Jesus is talking about himself as the temple. They did not get the meaning of new birth, and they do not get it now when he's talking about being life-giving bread. They hear Jesus talking about bread, and they immediately assume that he's referring to grub. Jesus served them by miraculously feeding 5,000, and in response, they attempt to make him king. They just did not get it. So why is it that we think that we are any better? If we truly don't have Jesus all figured out, then what in the world have we got to say about the meaning of communion? I am the bread of life, said Jesus. Huh? What? Ew. I mean, that must have sounded like cannibalism to those people. Okay, so sometimes we are to take Jesus literally, and sometimes we are to take him figuratively. But how are we supposed to know when? Especially since the disciples, who we lovingly refer to sometimes as the disciples, they didn't seem to get it any better than we do. What is it that Jesus truly meant when he said, "This is my body, this is my blood"? What does Jesus mean when he says that he is the bread of life? What does this Jesus diet really mean for us? Well, like I said last Sunday, hunger is a universal experience. None of us is immune, and it's not something that we can avoid. No matter how many throwed rolls my family tried to consume at Lambert's Cafe this past week, unfortunately, after a few hours, guess what happened? We got hungry again. And so Jesus takes all this focus on physical hunger, and he turns it into a teachable moment about spiritual hunger. And there are a lot of similarities between physical hunger and spiritual hunger. And as we need to be fed daily, we won't grow unless we're fed. We need to consume healthy stuff, not just a diet of junk. And we won't ever stop being hungry. And yet, to me, there's one huge difference between physical hunger and spiritual hunger. And that is that when we are physically hungry, it's pretty obvious that we need to eat something. You know, our stomachs growl, we get lightheaded, our blood sugar drops, you know, et cetera, et cetera. But when we're spiritually hungry, it's not always that obvious, is it? We don't always know when we're running on spiritual empty. And we may sense that there's something definitely wrong, that there's something missing, but we also may not understand or realize that we may be on the completely wrong diet. The Jesus diet is when the one who speaks to us in this strangely metaphorical way is the very one who desires that we not only think about him, but that we feed on him, that we ingest him, we embody him. And the whole implication of the Jesus diet is that we could starve to death without it. Thanks be to God that he loves us this much. Well, it's now time to lift up our praises and prayer concerns. And we have some listed on our bulletin. A big praise is Linda Lidgard and her good diagnosis. Any other praises or prayer concerns we need to lift up? Oh, yeah, sorry. Is she really? My college-age daughter is home, and she has decided to share some of that. In case we miss her when she leaves again. Yes, ma'am. Sarai and Isaac. Any others? Yes. Is it really? Oh, wow. General conference. Yes. Yeah, you got to get practice saying that now. Right. I hope it all goes well. Yes. There's a lot of brokenness in our world. Yes. else may lift up.
My uncle this week was diagnosed with lymphoma.
Oh.
John LaSalle.
Anything else may lift up? Hopefully something will turn up. Anything else may lift up? Let us turn to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we are so blessed and we are so thankful. And even though we are blessed and thankful, Lord, we understand that we cannot ever be thankful enough for the kind of love that you pour out for us and the kind of love that you pour into us. For Lord, there is a lot of brokenness in the world. We see it around us, so much suffering that it is overwhelming, and we don't even know where to start. But Lord, we lift up those that are broken, especially those who are spiritually broken, and we turn them over to you, Lord, understanding that we are your hands and feet here on your creation, but that there's also the power of prayer, that we can be ways of your voice, we can be ways of healing that no one else can be. So we continue to pray for your guidance, for opening our eyes and our hearts and our ears to the ways that we can be your presence in this broken world. And Lord, continue to be with those that we've named today and the many others that we lift up to you on our hearts. May they continue to know your presence and your healing touch. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, it's now time to give of our tithes and our offerings. Lord, we pray that you receive these gifts, bless them as we use them in your service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
One day, eyes that are blind will see you clearly. One day, all who deny will find me believe. One day, hearts made of stone will break in pieces. And one day, chains once unbroken will fall down at your feet. So we wait for that one day. Come quickly. We want to see your glory. Every knee falls down before thee. Every tongue offers you praise. Every hand raised, singing glory to you and unto you only, we'll sing glory to your name.
One day, voices that lie will all be silenced. One day,
all that's divided
will be whole again. One day, death will
Be seated. If you will take out your hymnals and turn with me to page 12. And on page 12, we start with the invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. And now to the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body of Christ and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now let us pray as we have been taught to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Those who are assisting with serving communion, I ask them to please come forward. In our United Methodist tradition, this table physically is here, but it does not belong to us. It is the Lord's table. And so it is open and available for everyone to receive God's grace. The method that we use is called intinction, which I finally refer to as dip and drip. You will come up and receive a small portion of the bread that's a symbol of the body of Christ, and then you dip that into the cup. So come and receive the small portion of God's grace. It is ready for you. Thank you.
stand and join us, please.
You are beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words, too wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depths of your love? You are beautiful beyond description, majesty enthroned above. And I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. You are beautiful beyond description,
too marvelous for words.
Too marvelous for words.
Too wonderful for comprehension.
Too wonderful for comprehension.
Like nothing ever seen or heard.
Like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom?
Who can fathom the depth of your love?
Who can fathom the depth of beyond description,
majesty enthroned above,
majesty enthroned above. And I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to
I stand.
And I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you.
Blessing. Our worship here is ended, but our service just now begins. As you leave this place, remember just how much you are loved and share that love with someone else. Go in peace. Amen.
Amen.
I know.